Can I get a mic or a mic and a half? That source owe me. Shout out to the editors there. Yeah, I'm all grown, so much better with math. I need a spread in the Forbes, taking a Benjamin bath. Yeah, I'm serving this track like Steffi Graf. Yeah, Roger Federer, there's no competitor.
Urban Tennis, episode 41, The Diamond Games. Welcome back, everyone, to the Tennis Podcast. I'm your host, joined by my co-host.
How do you do?
Very good. This is our first podcast since the Australian Open. We're recording on February 12th, 2015, so we have a lot of things to catch up on. Firstly, obviously the results of the Australian Open. We'll talk about Djokovic winning his fifth title in Australia and how he's kind of become, for Melbourne, what Rafa is to Roland Garros. Plus, what the result means for Andy and the animosity that a lot of the weekend's matches created on the ATP. Second, we're going to talk about Serena, who wins her 19th title, and how this kind of sets up her year in 2015. Is it going to be a more relaxed year? Plus the huge news that she'll be returning to Indian Wells more than a decade after a nasty incident that has kept two of the most predominant WTA players, Serena and Venus, out of possibly the biggest growing tournament in the world. Next, we're going to be talking about this week's events. We're in the midst of two big European events, Rotterdam and ATP 500, and Antwerp, the Diamond Games, where we get our title. Talk about what's going on, struggles early on for Genie Bouchard and her new coach, how that's going to kind of mesh together. And then in our media technology segment, we're going to talk about Leighton Hewitt and his long run to retirement in early 2016. So if you're ready, let's get started with episode 41. So early on Super Bowl Sunday, if you're a tennis fan and a football fan, you had a busy schedule. And it began with a fairly competitive match between Novak and Andy. First two sets, not a lot of difference. And it turns midway through the third. Novak, you know, people complaining, and that's kind of the fallout of the tournament, whether some of his dramatics or drama that he created over his conditioning and the pauses he took, how that affected Andy Murray. But he puts the pedal down, wins that fourth set in 6-love to claim his fifth Australian Open title, fourth in 5 years. Just kind of summarize what this means in, I guess, a greater scale of now a Novak outside of the Australians who dominated this tournament pre-Open era. He has to be considered the best player ever at the Australian Open. And will he kind of use the Australian Open as his personal, like, title check, title counter? You know, like how Nadal has done in Roland Garros, how Federer has done successfully at Wimbledon.
I honestly think that was the case before this tournament, because you kind of had that sense going into this tournament. Nobody had a shot against Novak Djokovic unless Novak Djokovic beat himself. And that's pretty much what we saw in this tournament.
Yeah, absolutely. Like, I think the reasons that Novak does so well, obviously, in Australia, first, a great court for him, you know, has had a ton of success. You know, not many people can beat Novak Djokovic right now on an indoor hard court, outdoor hard court, in these kind of conditions. He does better, it seems, seemingly after a short winter break than any of the other competitors. Even when he was, say, playing his B game in the middle of the tournament, Steele really had no troubles against anybody. So that the match against Wawrinka, the semis, it went five sets, but it was such an up-and-down match where you never felt that Djokovic had lost anything. And like you said, you know, I still think he needed to win this one to go back on the, say, he owns this place. You know, if you lose the same tournament 2 years in a row, you kind of lose your grasp of, hey, I'm the king of Melbourne. But I think he's well on that pace. And like we said, he's going to be the favorite at this tournament for the foreseeable future. But it was also a great tournament for Andy Murray, who, you know, hadn't reached a Grand Slam final since 2013 Wimbledon, the one he won. He's kind of moved past the back injury. You know, the fallout of the tournament was Andy really not respecting or feeling the actions Novak did during the tournament. There was also some bitterness that Kim Sears got pulled into in the Andy Murray-Tomas Berdych match in the semis. Tell us how you judge now Andy Murray after this tournament and any importance or any placement placed on the animosity kind of that Andy Murray had with a couple of his, you know, supposedly fraternal brothers in the ATP.
Well, first thing I'm going to actually talk about is encore performance. I think it was definitely encouraging, like you mentioned, because even in that final where Novak did win in four sets, Andy Murray had like those two or three times where if he just didn't make those big unforced errors, he could have turned those sets the other way. And he, who knows, we might be talking about Andy Murray, Australian Open champion, if he just doesn't make those simple mistakes. But it's just like we saw in like 2012 where Andy Murray, he gets to these finals, he looks so close, and then it just slips by him. So if he can just get over those hurdles for the next, for whenever he plays at Wimbledon, whenever he plays at, maybe not the French Open, to be honest, maybe the US Open, then we can probably talk about Andy Murray having a quote-unquote return to form. But as far as a dispute with his on-court brothers, to say so to speak, I could see how that could affect Andy Murray. I mean, he's definitely a lot more emotional player than, not to say that Djokovic isn't an emotional player. He is too, but versus, you know, Nadal or Federer, they keep their animosity to themselves and they really don't really see it as much. So it can definitely affect him for sure, but I feel like it's not a worry yet.
Yeah, I agree. I don't think it's necessarily a bad thing. It's probably the new normal. I know hearing this on the No Challenges Remaining podcast with Ben Rothenberg and Courtney Nguyen, they talked about how they liked it, how that Roger Federer's kind of grasp as the gentleman's ATP is kind of ending, and that this is actually maybe the truer form of what the ATP is. You know, guys who are fighting so close to a Grand Slam, you know, there should be some personal animus, right? You're basically a set and a half away from winning a Grand Slam, from losing a Grand Slam. So if you don't care or if there's no outward emotions, you know, it's easy to justify why there is a little bit of anger from Thomas Berdych, who felt he had a great opportunity after he beat Nadal, and then he's really mad what he performed and how he performed against Andy Murray. So it's probably the new normal. I don't think it's a huge issue. Will it change some sort of relationships we have? You know, the Murray-Djokovic relationship, they kind of came up together, so maybe that's slightly changing. But right now, it's so nascent that we don't know what's going to happen. You know, usually when you get older, things mature, things mellow out, so that relationship will probably mellow out. Okay, let's talk about Serena Williams, who, you know, often designates titles that she really wants. I remember 2013 in Paris, Roland Garros, she wanted that title. She hadn't won since 2002. This Australian Open title, she hadn't won since 2010. She said she wanted it, and she got it done. So I don't know if you want to talk about her designating titles and if that means anything. But I think this title, this 19th Grand Slam, really, and winning it so early, frees her up, I think. I think it's going to be carefree Serena in 2015, much more relaxed. She put a lot of pressure on herself to get to number 18, and she did do well in slams last year until the U.S. Open. So I think she's going to be relaxed. I think that's going to help her results. You know, I don't think right away she's going to have an easy path to the French Open title, which is traditionally her hardest title to win, but I think she's going to be more relaxed in 2015. Any comment?
Yeah, definitely. But on the other side, will the tennis field either benefit from that? Will we see Serena Williams maybe come into the French Open not on her top game, and she gets her early round exits, which are the only time where she doesn't win a Grand Slam is when she has an early round exit. So could we see that be better if you do want to see more fresh faces win these new slams? I'm sure we're going to talk about, you know, the Bouchard, even Madison Keys now. It's the list goes on and on.
Yeah, you can add Garbiñ Muguruza, who probably played Serena the best at the Australian Open. You know, I think it's a good thing. You know, she's going to be relaxed, so I don't think it's going to affect her more. Say she loses in the third or fourth round in the French. I don't think it's going to affect her as much as, say, if she had done poorly at the Australian Open. So it's gonna be a tough thing to see. Obviously, she's always the favorite in any slam, but I think it's a good thing. Like either she loses early and we see a new face, or she's keeps his dominance going through 2015. A relaxed Serena playing better, playing, you know, without the burdens of not having won a slam in a year is better for the tour. But Serena also made really big news when she announced this past week that she would be returning to Indian Wells, the premier tournament played in California for the first time in over a decade. And if you're not familiar with the backstory, there are claims made that Serena personally felt that she was mistreated by fans, quite frankly, racist remarks, after Venus had to withdraw from a semifinal matchup against Serena, and that when she played in the final in Indian Wells that year, she felt a lot of vitriol from the fans, from even the organizers of the tournament. So obviously this is a big step for Serena, returning to a place that she's held this incident as just one of the kind of bulletin board materials she has of growing up in Compton in California, two black girls, made it out of nowhere, kind of the impetus to do even better. Of late, Serena obviously now knows her place in tennis, how she feels happy or she feels good knowing that, hey, I have a chance to get to 22, 23 Grand Slams. Why not keep going? So obviously a huge personal step for her. If you are an organizer at Indian Wells, should you treat her differently when she comes back? Should there be extra attention put to Serena, or do you have to kind of treat it like those things are behind us now, we're just moving forward as a tournament?
Well, by nature, he is going to get special treatment because this is such a big step for not only the tennis world, for just like big relations in the media with Serena Williams and her perception. Because this is really a big step overall, because there's going to be a lot of questions. Okay, why now? Why this year? Is anything different from when you were last year in 2001? It's just, there's going to be a focus on her, but I think the key is, and I think the key thing that both parties want out of this is that at the end of the day, Serena Williams is forgiving Indian Wells. And I think the best way she can do that is keeping her head focused on the tournament and showing that, yes, there was some mistakes in the past made, but we're here to make those things up and for a better future.
No, I agree. And I think she hasn't committed beyond 1 year, so this could be just a 1 year reclamation project by her. But hopefully both parties are poised to show a lot of integrity and kind of use this as a stepping stone to, you know, furthering both Indian Wells' place in history and Serena Williams' place in history and how they can reconcile together. Moving on, we're recording this early in the evening on Thursday, February 12th. The evening matches have just begun, and we have Stan Wawrinka in Rotterdam pulling out a three-set match. Earlier, Andy Murray beat Vasek Pospisil, Tomas Berdych won. So Milos Raonic is about to step on the court. So seems like things are going to as directed in Rotterdam. A good opportunity for all these men. Berdych won this tournament last year. There's a huge logjam right now between, you know, where Andy Murray is to Stan Wawrinka is. So these tournaments, when you don't have a Nadal, a Djokovic, a Federer, it's good to see who's really kind of taking the most out of these opportunities. Especially for somebody like Milos Raonic, who's always been criticized that he can beat somebody underneath him who he's expected to beat, but has trouble when he has to step up. So it'll be a good opportunity to see if he can make some hay during the weekend. Well, in Antwerp, we have a premier WTA event headlined by Angelique Kerber and Genie Bouchard, but both of them already out in their first matches. Kerber losing 6-1, 6-1 to Kuznetsova. That's just hard to explain. Maybe Kerber's just kind of hit that wall where her consistency that she showed in 2012 is not there anymore. Genie, who came into this tournament, she sat out of the Fed Cup last weekend, but she announced a new coach, Victoria Azarenka's former coach, Sam Sumik. Obviously, it's never seamless, but what can a new coach, especially a coach that's helped transform Victoria Azarenka, who's an erratic, talented young player who had a lot of inconsistency and helped vault her to a two-time Grand Slam champion and maybe one of the three or four most feared players on the WTA. What can a relationship or what can a coach like that do for Genie Bouchard as she tries to continue her evolution on tour?
Well, I guess the key is handling that big stage pressure. I mean, she's been in the situation before, and it's been a mixed bag so far. I think obviously the most glaring observation was her first round exit playing in her hometown of Montreal. So, and then I think it was well recorded her meeting with Nick Saviano last year, where she says, "I just don't want to go out there anymore." So, if she can find a way to put like small losses, small setbacks like that behind her and move on to the next part of the tour, then I think she could go a lot further, more consistently in her future.
Yeah, that's key. Like, you know, it's great that she's shown such progression at Grand Slams and she's such a tough out at Grand Slam tournaments, but it's tournaments like these, you know, you're the number one seed here. Kim Clijsters has talked about how perfect it is to have Genie Bouchard in Antwerp and how it helps a tournament, both for the directors and both for the fans, but then you got to take advantage of these if you're Genie. You know, you're not going to get many chances when you don't have to be in a tournament with Petra or with Simona or Maria or Serena. You know, these are tournaments that she has to make deep runs in. You know, that's just part of her maturation process. You know, she's got to start winning or going deep in events like this. So it's a very disappointing week for Genie Bouchard. Okay, moving on to our media and technology segment. At the end of the Australian Open, rumors emerged that Tennis Australia had announced that Leighton Hewitt would essentially retire after the 2016 Australian Open. And it got us here at the podcast thinking, you know, we don't want that traditional, you know, year-long retirement party that the grand champion is feted everywhere. And we brought up the example of Steve Nash, who worked with Grantland.com to create a web series, basically the Finish Line, from the athlete's perspective. So an unfiltered version of how it feels approaching the end after so many years, you know, when your body can't do it more, what retirement means. So I don't know if Leighton Hewitt is the greatest candidate, but I thought it'd be a great exercise to see what tennis player would you want to see film a Steve Nash-esque Finish Line?
Wow, that's a pretty good question. I think I'd have to go with Andy Murray. I mean, just because he's kind of in that weird point where he's done maybe a little bit more than Leighton Hewitt in his career, but not as much as the other three, his other three contemporaries, obviously. So it feels like he has that same level of respect that a Steve Nash does, but he knows he'll never be at the top stage. So it'd be interesting to see his perspective of winding down his tennis career thinking about his place and his future legacy, because it's really quite undetermined at this point. So whenever it comes to his retirement, it'd be interesting to see how he thinks of his legacy at that time.
I thought of instantly two names. First, someone closer to retirement, obviously, David Ferrer. It'd be just great to see pick his brain on how someone can have so much success on tour. You know, David Ferrer is going to win 600, maybe 700 matches in his career, multiple tournaments. But, you know, to face that roadblock every time and never get over it, that'd be an interesting look at, like, what it takes to be just good enough. Like, if you're comparing it to an NBA team, a team that kept going to the conference finals, like the Knicks of the 90s, you know, a team that was on the verge of winning but never did. And someone I think would be interesting in more of a sociological sense would be John Isner. You know, it's a tour now, the ATP, that has dramatically become Eurocentric, even Asian-centric. To see his tales of what it felt like being one of the lone American stars, someone who had to you know, how his challenges of even like relating to people on tour, you know, after this shift to being much more of a, you know, Eastern European dominated sport. So he and John Isner is, I think, a great character in himself, that he would provide a lot of color into a web series like that. So maybe in a couple of years, we'll see a tennis version of The Finish Line. Okay, we're almost nearing the end of this episode, but like always, we like to end with certain games or exciting announcements. So we're going to start off with a game of volleys, which is basically a this or that. Firstly, Grigor Dimitrov, who suffered a pretty bad loss in his first matchup in Rotterdam, coming off that choke job against Andy Murray in the fourth set. Do you believe that Dimitrov is closer to winning, like, say, Ake Nishikori and Milos Raonic, or is he slipping behind those guys?
I think he's slipping behind, because it feels like he's hitting that like that David Ferreira hump where he's competing with these guys right now, but he's not crossing it. We saw Nishikori kind of cross it, like making the US Open final. Obviously, that's a great achievement in itself, but I don't know. Maybe Dimitrov will prove us wrong when it comes for the next Grand Slam season.
I know his results say that he's slipping, but I say he's still there. He's got all the tools. You know, he is the perfect composition of what you expect a Grand Slam champion to be. So I still think he's in the hunt. He's in that description with Nishikori and Raonic. Moving on. Now, almost 2 weeks ago, Tunisian player Malik Djaziri pulled out of a match that he was leading because in his next match he would have faced an Israeli player. And there is implications that both him and the Tunisian Tennis Association would not ever dare face an Israeli player. Now, the ATP hasn't really, they're investigating, but there hasn't been a judgment. If Djaziri is found guilty, or the Tunisian Association is guilty, are you satisfied with how the ATP is handling this discussion? And if you aren't, what should be done?
I think I definitely, if it's found to be true, I want stiff punishments for the player and the federation, of course. But it's always so difficult to determine in tennis why withdrawal happened, because we see withdrawals all the time. I mean, we saw a withdrawal in the ATP World Tour Finals of all things. So it's difficult. It'd be a big challenge for the ATP and their investigation to determine what actually happened here. But I hope they find out the truth, and if it turns out to be that he withdrew because he didn't want to face the Israeli player, I hope it's dealt with appropriately.
Yeah, I agree. It's so difficult in tennis, you know, even though he did play in Memphis the next week, so we'll see about that. But I think the ATP so far has not been very authoritative in what they're handling the situation with. I hope, even if it's not found guilty, that they can still use this example as a learning point. You know, you have to be creating the most cooperative association you can. There's no room for division. If there is, you have to find the root of it and try to solve it. Otherwise, you feel like you're a void power. And if the ATP already is not a very strong association, just because of the nature of the sport and how they're basically individual contractors, so you got to find a way to put your foot down when you can. Okay, lastly, our last volley is the WTA Draw Challenge is starting up again. I know my co-host had a lot of success last year, actually winning Singapore Championships draw. Are you in or out this year with the WTA Draw Challenge?
I'm in. I'm ready to defend my title. But just as an aside, I feel kind of bad. That article, it had my picture and mainly mentioned me in the first two paragraphs. But the season winner was like mentioned in a brief sentence after. That's a little unfair, and I hope they change that this year. The season winner should definitely be recognized more than the winner of the final tournament of the year.
Yeah, I agree. And I'm also in this year. Hopefully they can come up with a prize or two that kind of adds the incentive, but it's always nice to make some fun picks before a challenge. Okay, our social media highlight of the week.
All right, our social media highlight of the week goes back to February 1st on the final of the Australian Open. We saw Andy Murray's fiance Kim Sears stand up and reveal she was wearing a shirt that said parental advisory, explicit content. And that definitely caught a lot of chatter, even more chatter than her initial outburst that she was referring to, that she was swearing while she was on TV in retaliation to a Thomas Burdick call. That's what it was, yes. And so it was definitely really good, and it showed a lot of character that a lot of players are not only from the players, but also from their spouses or wags, whatever.
Definitely some added personality can never help. Thank you for listening. Hope you enjoy the rest of Rotterdam and Antwerp. And once again, Kim Clijsters and everybody at Antwerp, the Diamond Games, that's a great title. Great title for a tournament. Keep listening. Previous episodes on YouTube, search Urban Tennis. This episode can be downloaded at SoundCloud, searching the Urban Tennis Network. You can read about the blog and the past articles on urbantennis.wordpress.com. Thank you for joining us. Episode 41, The Diamond Games.
Leave in the night. I've no fear that they might desert me. Diamonds are forever.
Throw your diamonds in the sky if you feel the vibe.
Diamonds are forever.
The rock is still alive every time I rhyme. Forever, ever, forever, ever, ever, ever. The magic Vegas on acid, seen through East Saint Laurent glasses, and I've realized that I've arrived, cause it take more than a magazine to kill my vibe. Does he write his own rhymes? Just sort of, I thank him, that mean I forget better than you ever thought of. Damn, is he really that caught up? I ask, if you talking about classes, do my name get brought up? I remember I couldn't afford a Ford Escort, or even a Ford Track Recorder. So it's only right that I let the top chop on a drop top Porsche. For yourself, that's important. If you strip her name Porsche and you get tips from any man, then your fat friend, her nickname is Minivan. Excuse me, that's just the Henny, man. I smoke, I drink, I'm supposed to stop, I can't because
diamonds are forever.
Throw your diamonds in the sky if you feel the vibe.
Diamonds are forever.
The rock is still alive every time I rhyme.
Forever.